Good afternoon and welcome to the 10th Annual Sacred Trust History Talks and Book Signing Event presented by the Gettysburg Foundation and Gettysburg National Military Park. My name is Dan Welch and I'm the Education Programs Coordinator for the Gettysburg Foundation, which is the nonprofit partner of the National Park Service here at Gettysburg. Over the years, as we've presented Sacred Trust, we have had the distinct pleasure of hosting renowned Civil War historians, authors, National Park Service rangers, and licensed battlefield guides, so that they can share their unique perspectives on the Battle of Gettysburg with you, our visitors and guests. Coming up next, Dr. Brian Craig Miller will present Remembering Failure, John Bell Hood in Civil War History and Memory. General John Bell Hood has rarely been memorialized in something more lasting than bronze or marble. His life and military career have been heavily criticized. Is there more to the man than his failures? This presentation will delve into the varied memories of this most controversial commander in an attempt to better understand the man, the myth, and the memory of John Bell Hood. Dr. Miller is currently the series editor for The South in the Civil War, offered through Kent State University, book review editor for Civil War History, and associate professor and associate chair of history at Emporia State University. Author of many books, articles, papers, and monographs, he is the recipient of the 2014 Ballard Bro Visiting Fellowship presented by the Filson Historical Society. Please welcome Dr. Brian Craig Miller.
Well, thank you very much for that wonderful introduction, Dan, and thank you so much to Cindy and Mandy Moore here with Sacred Trust and the National Park Service. It is a great thrill to be back in Gettysburg, a place that I clearly have spent more time than John Bell Hood ever did. In fact, those of you in attendance today will spend more time than John Bell Hood did of significance here at Gettysburg. And what a great time to come back to Gettysburg here on the anniversary weekend. As I've been traveling around town and over at the Wyndham Hotel, there were numerous Union generals holding camp last night. Unfortunately, Burnside, Hooker, and Rosecrans are not present, and they're looking for those. So if you are interested in joining and impersonating one of those generals, you should certainly contact those men. This is a place that is very dear to my heart because my parents, who are in the audience today but have been strictly told that they are not allowed to identify themselves nor ask questions throughout this presentation, and my brother is here as well, used to come to Gettysburg all the time. We climb around the rocks and just have a great time at Devil's Den. In fact, yesterday I saw a small young boy, probably 6 or 7, with his Civil War hat on, climbing over the rocks, and I said to myself, that kid is going to grow up and be a Braxton Bragg biographer. And his parents don't know it yet, but that is going to be his life choice. Angry, a gambler, confused, lacking moral courage, living in a dream world torn somewhere between the realities and memory during the more romantic days, ill-mannered hellion with streaks of wildness and nonconformity, a drinker, and possible drug abuser, impulsive, reckless, fearless, brainless, a dim thinker, battered, beaten, discredited, and a hopeless cripple, no evidence of mental brilliance, a tragic failure, a sad, pathetic person. No, I have not just provided you a list of terms used to describe the performance of the Pittsburgh Steelers last season, or the Philadelphia Phillies this season. Do you like that? I hit both sides of the state, right, in one shot there. But rather, they are a description of how historians have talked about Civil War General John Bell Hood, who has mostly been judged by history for a course of military failures that span 6 months of his entire life. Thus, John Bell Hood has rarely been memorialized in something more lasting than bronze and marble. The battlefields where Hood commanded at Franklin, Nashville, and Atlanta are now covered with country music star mansions and big box stores where you can purchase live bait and organic arugula under one roof. Only in the last few years did a historical marker appear at the grave of John Bell Hood in Metairie, Louisiana, amidst a sea of identical tombs. Other than Fort Hood in Texas, The monument in Austin, Texas, to the Texas Brigade, the group that he commanded early in the Civil War, he has no other monument, no statue, and little place in the popular memory of the Civil War, as you would be hard-pressed to find a John Bell Hood bobblehead along the shops of Steinware Avenue. Now, Hood has always drawn a strong reaction from both historians and his contemporaries. Following the Battle of Antietam in September of 1862, Major Thomas J. Gorey, who was an aide to General James Longstreet, wrote, "It is very probable that General Hood will be promoted to Major General for his gallantry in these various contests. No man deserves it more. He is one of the finest young officers I ever saw. And had we many more of the like sort at Sharpsburg, we would have whipped the Yankees worse than they were ever whipped before." General Thomas Stonewall Jackson noted after the battle, "I regard him as one of the most promising officers in the Army." But 2 years later, the perception of John Bell Hood had rapidly shifted from potential hero to zero. Following the battles at Franklin and Nashville in late 1864, Captain Samuel T. Foster wrote the following, "General Hood has betrayed us. This is not the kind of fighting he promised. This was not a fight with equal numbers. The wails and cries of widows and orphans made at Franklin, Tennessee, November 30th, 1864, will heat up the fires of the bottomless pit to burn the soul of General J.B. Hood for murdering their husbands and fathers at that place that day. It can't be called anything else but cold-blooded murder." The Richmond Whig reflected similar sentences as a rather hashtag gloomy, that's for all the kids out there watching on the Twitter, editorial stated, "It was a black day for the Army of Tennessee, the day the command was taken from General Johnston and conferred on General Hood. A brave man, it is true, and an excellent division commander, but a man wanting in ability, as everybody at all acquainted with him will be ready to testify. General Hood was soon flanked, beaten, and compelled to abandon Atlanta. He then stepped out of the way, hat in hand, and asked Sherman to walk through Georgia. He himself moved up to Tennessee, where he has gotten beaten, and this time we fear badly enough." Now, Civil War historians largely agree that John Bell Hood was not the brightest bulb in the Confederate chandelier of high command. In fact, he would probably make very close to the top of the top 10 list of Confederate commanders and even Union commanders who were enormous disappointments during the war. Folks like Braxton Bragg, Rosecrans, and even Joe Johnston, who I like to tell my students that if Joe Johnston was your colleague in business, he would be the guy who always advocated that your company go on retreat. I get the same reaction from my students in Kansas. Now, one cannot deny that Hood's army failed to secure victory for the Confederacy during the war, but at the same time, it is the interpretation of the man and his place in Civil War history that is problematic. Historian Stephen Woodworth, in a collection on Civil War generals who failed in battle, noted that recent accounts about Hood lead a reader to wonder not why he held command of an army, but rather why he was not in an insane asylum. So who is this John Bell Hood, the man who draws such strong reactions from historians and his contemporaries? John Bell Hood, who was born in 1831, grew up in Mount Sterling, Kentucky, as the son of a prosperous slaveholding doctor. At the age of 18, Hood entered the United States Military Academy, graduating in 1853, ranked 44 out of 52 students. Although he did not excel in the classroom, Hood showed an enormous amount of proficiency in military activities and summer encampments that routinely tested his ability to handle the actual mechanics of war. Upon his departure from West Point, Hood spent the rest of the 1850s in the U.S. Army fighting Native Americans on the frontier, particularly in the state of Texas. When Kentucky refused to secede in 1861, Hood adopted the state of Texas as his new home, taking up arms with the Confederacy. Hood quickly rose through the ranks while commanding the Texas Brigade. Courageous and successful fighting at Gaines Mill, 2nd Manassas, and Sharpsburg served notice of Hood's promise as an officer. But at the same time, it was his personal command style which instilled love and admiration from the Texas troops that fought by his side. Severe wounds removed Hood from the field in two critical battles. At Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, on July 2nd of 1863, Hood lost the usage of his left arm. During the engagement at Chickamauga 2 months later in Georgia, Hood lost his right leg, sending him to Richmond to recover from a dangerous amputation with a low survival rate. He eventually re-entered military service, now as a corps commander with the Army of Tennessee, currently then led by General Joseph E. Johnston. From the moment of Hood's arrival in North Georgia, drama emerged between the diva triumvirates of Confederate leadership, Jefferson Davis, Hood, and Johnston, ultimately leading to Johnston's removal and Hood being named as commander of the Army of Tennessee. Hood faced a precarious situation as commander, as disorganization, a superior enemy force, and poor leadership skills and broken down communication led to failures and disaster at Atlanta, Spring Hill, Franklin, and Nashville. Hood resigned as commander in early 1865 and after the war became a businessman and philanthropist in New Orleans, which I chronicle quite extensively in my book, available for sales inside the gift shop after my talk today, where Hood sold life insurance policies and worked on behalf of widows, orphans, and wounded veterans. He also married, fathered 11 children, including three sets of twins, and spent his post-war years defending his military career until yellow fever struck the general and took his life in 1879. For my talk today, I want to focus specifically on some of the main areas of emphasis pertaining to the memory of John Bell Hood, paying particular attention to veteran reunions, the memory wars, tributes at the time of his death, and the living monuments that have replaced statues and granite monuments across the landscape. Now, following the end of the Civil War, Hood spent some time traveling in Texas and Kentucky before settling down as an insurance salesman in New Orleans. At first, Hood did not seem much focused on the memory of the war, or even his own performance in that war. He issued a circular to the newspapers to collect as much information as he possibly could about the war, and those officers and men who served with him under his command. Hood showed no interest in writing a history of the war, but he wanted, he said, to collect facts with regard to military operations. Hood argued in this circular, "It will remain for the historian who shall aspire to draw a truthful picture of the eventful and interesting epoch with which I was somewhat connected, to assign to the facts embraced in these memorials their proper place and just significance." An editorial writer in Arkansas championed Hood's request, particularly since he felt that without these historical contributions, future historians would not be able to construct narratives and thus would not do justice to a noble people. Instead, Hood turned his attention to charitable endeavors, where he raised money for widows, orphans, and injured soldiers from the Civil War, and even the Franco-Prussian War. But things started to change in early May of 1869 when citizens gathered on Camp Street in New Orleans to organize a permanent society for the purpose of collecting and preserving records and memorandum of the Confederacy. By examining the Civil War from a Southern standpoint, the Southern Historical Society sought to collect only such data as is perfectly reliable and correct. In order to get at the true Southern story, they claimed, and to become one of the earliest and most important mouthpieces for the lost cause memory of the Civil War, the Society hoped to collect information from individuals who held knowledge of the interior workings of the military and the government. The Society invited commentaries from all living Confederate leaders, including John Bell Hood. Now, during its early years, the Southern Historical Society stayed off of Hood's radar as he instead focused on his own well-being, his marriage, and commemoration of his soldiers from Texas. On June 27, 1871, a few surviving members of Hood's Texas Brigade gathered in Barton Springs, Texas. The reunion gathered to celebrate the 9th anniversary of the battle at Gaines Mill. During the important gathering, the small group felt it necessary for all surviving members of the Texas Brigade to begin meeting in commemoration on a yearly basis. Thus, the call went out for all veterans to gather on May 14, 1872 in Houston. 66 members, including Hood, met and established the annual proceedings of the Memorial and Reunion Association of Hood's Texas Brigade, Army of Northern Virginia. No more than 400, though, attended the reunion. The Texas Brigade had gone from 24,000 members in 1861 to 4,000 in 1865, and now 400 at the reunion in 1872. As Henry Thomas wrote of the reunion, every seat was filled with a war-worn veteran of the brigade, their beloved commander, General Hood, occupying the chair of honor at the head. After an opening prayer by former chaplain Nicholas Davis, General Robertson called that John Bell Hood should be elected president. And without hesitation, the moment and the resolution were adopted by acclamation. Hood spoke at the meeting that day to accept the presidency, endorsing the creation of this association, and said, "Comrades in arms, I thank you for the honor that you have conferred upon me. It is useless to attempt to express the happiness that I feel, those upon whose countenances so much is pictured in the past. Time has done its work, leaving only a few brave hearts to stand as sentinels over precious memories." Hood urged the present members to not forget the 18th Georgia and 3rd Arkansas, who had not attended the event but had been valued members of Hood's command. Hood then concluded, "Hereafter, next to my own family, the survivors of that body with whom I passed through so many trials and dangers are nearer and dearer to me than all others upon earth. Since coming into your midst, recollections have rushed through my brain that almost staggers me of incidents that transpired from 1861 to 1865. I stand, as it were, in your midst with a tear and a smile, a tear of sadness for memories of the past and a smile of hope for the future. Comrades, you have done your duty nobly as soldiers. Continue to do your duty as nobly as citizens, trusting that God will someday give you that liberty which you claim as an inheritance from your forefathers." Now, because he lived in New Orleans, Hood agreed to serve as temporary chairman, but decided to decline the post as president. After Hood's speech, the association passed several resolutions, including perpetuating remembrance of widows and orphans of comrades who died in defense of the cause. The chief objective of the society, the friendly and social reunion of its survivors, sought to collect and perpetuate all incidents, anecdotes, history, and everything connected therewith, and to succor the needy among its members. The meeting concluded with a brief address by General Robertson and then the reading of a poem entitled "Greetings to Hood's Brigade" by Mrs. M.J. Young from Texas. At the conclusion of the poem, the veterans raised a silent toast to pay tribute to General Lee and their dead comrades. The scene was most affecting, and many a tear trickled down many a veteran cheek during the solemn ceremony, which concluded by each passing silently out, extending their hands to the poetess of the occasion in a final adieu, noted one observer. The warm memories that swelled amongst the Texas Brigade and John Bell Hood did not last long in the realm of Hood's own life. On August 14, 1873, a meeting took place in Virginia where members of the Southern Historical Society met to call for the movement of the organization from New Orleans, Hood's base of support, where he was beloved as a local businessman and philanthropist, to Richmond, Virginia. At the same time, the organization would now seek to answer one key question: who should receive blame for the failure of the Confederacy? The Society, through lengthy tactical addresses, explained the technical elements of each Confederate defeat. In the world of the Virginia-dominated Southern Historical Society, the truth became difficult to locate within a series of conflicting memories. Yet it became crystal clear that Hood would receive some unflattering assessments of his military ability and command performance, with most of the Raiders of the Lost Ark-esque boulder of blame rolling towards James Longstreet. Officers offered speeches and published writings to cast an eye of blame squarely upon Hood for the failures at Atlanta and in Tennessee, while working desperately to solidify their own reputation. Thus, a memory war will break out in the pages of the Southern Historical Society published remarks and the memoirs of generals and soldiers that flooded stores across America. The tactically detailed memoirs and speeches bickered over the minuscule details of the war. One of the first officers to offer a memoir attacking Hood during the memory wars was Joseph Johnston. Before the work went to press, one writer noted, "General Johnston, in defending himself, must necessarily be aggressive. He must criticize very freely the actions and motives of military men and politicians wielding for the time the armies and authority of the Confederacy. And it is probable that this will draw out many replies." Citizens in New Orleans looked forward to the publication impatiently and expected an immense sale. Prior to the 1874 publication of General Johnston's memoir, which lacked a very marketable title, it was called Narrative of Military Operations Directed During the Late War Between the States. An advanced review copy ended up and appeared, this review did, in the pages of the New Orleans Daily Picayune. The reviewer did not share the enthusiasm among some of the expectant citizens for this book. He said, "But it seems that amity and concord cannot exist among our people, even upon the subject of their misfortunes. And there are hyenas in human form who stand ready to tear open the grave of the buried past and whet their insatiate appetites for revenge upon the slain heroes of the late war and spit their venom on those who survive." In particular, Johnston aimed much of his criticism directly at Hood. However, Johnston first needed to establish his own credibility. He disputed the reports that Hood issued in 1865, asserting that he had made gross official misstatements of the strength of the army and its losses. Hood's main attack on Johnston in the official war reports described a declining state of morale throughout the Army of Tennessee. Johnston refused this claim by pointing out the admirable conduct of those troops on every occasion. As he departed from command, Johnston remembered that the soldiers were full of devotion to him who had commanded them and belief of ultimate success in the campaign. The morale that Johnston had instilled brought courage and discipline, he claimed, to the army, even during the useless butchery at Franklin and when the men barely survived the rout and disorganization at Nashville. Here, Johnston brought up the fact that because he had been replaced by Hood, the army underwent a horrific period of unnecessary deaths that he, as a commander, would have avoided, probably because he would have strategically withdrawn away from the situation. The publication of Johnston's memoirs sought to rectify the Southern position in the North, not open up old wounds, according to one reviewer. When Johnston had been asked if he had been a little too bit critical of John Bell Hood, Johnston responded, "No. Nothing of the kind." Not only did the memoir publication create this feud between Johnston and Hood, but it also brought to light other issues from the war. Essentially, a line had been drawn in the realm of Civil War memory, and officers and soldiers had to decide whom they supported, Johnston or Hood. The memoir produced by Johnston serves as the onset of Hood's own post-war memory construction. Now Johnston had changed the terms of this memory construction, forcing Hood to now take a stand and fight for his own memory and his reputation. Johnston, in order to secure his place in memory, made Hood the scapegoat, ridiculed his military actions, and deflected any possible blame for his own failure at Atlanta. Furthermore, Johnston emphasized Hood's horrible defeats at Franklin and Nashville to mask his own inability to pursue a more aggressive strategy against Sherman at Atlanta. Johnston's overly technical, dry memoir sought to justify his reputation at the expense of Jefferson Davis and John Bell Hood. Johnston's memoir, although it sold poorly and was denied a spot on Oprah's book club, angered Hood. He began at once to construct a reply to Johnston that would take the shape of his own personal military autobiography and memoir. Hood wrote, "Although I feel by reason of injustice done me in the past that I have good cause to demand of our people the privilege of a hearing upon certain matters little understood by them, I would nevertheless have left the work of vindication to the unbiased historian of the future." Historians could not do Hood any justice, he said, because his words and actions had been so strangely misrepresented. Hood had no choice but to bring forth a reply, he called, to the erroneous and injurious statements in my regard brought forward by General Johnston. Hood felt he needed to protect his character against derogatory statements through self-defense or otherwise admit by silence the charges brought forth were true. Hood's memoir, entitled Advance and Retreat, Personal Experiences in the United States and Confederate States Armies, began with his military background prior to the war and some, but very brief, insights into the early years of the Civil War. The rest of the memoir receives the shockingly unoriginal title, Reply to General Johnston. Hood began to go point by point through Johnston's memoir, chipping away at the moments he felt he had been misrepresented. Hood worked to prove that the Army of Tennessee suffered a demoralizing tenure under Johnston because he could only render them of but little service in a pitched battle. Hood came to command the Army, he claimed, under embarrassing circumstances, considering the state of morale among both officers and the troops. Johnson's decisions while commanding in the Atlanta campaign seemed inappropriate and allowed morale to plummet, according to Hood. Hood inquired, was it General Johnston's policy to retreat till he had demoralized the enemy? Johnson had argued skilled retreat as the appropriate tactic in the Atlanta campaign. Johnson had even further criticized Hood and charged Hood with recklessness and exposure of my troops, Johnson called them, to useless butchery. Hood shrugged off this analysis and pointed out that Johnston's name would only be associated with one single glorious victory in the annals of our 4 years struggle. As Hood finished his manuscript and sought a publisher, yellow fever struck the city of New Orleans in the summer of 1879. On August 22nd, Hood's wife contracted the disease and died 2 days later. On August 27th, Hood's Texas Brigade sent a letter of heartfelt sympathy to the general in response to the death of his wife. The veterans wrote, "This affliction which has befallen you revives in us anew the sufferings and sorrows of the ill-fated past. When we were but as your children and comrades in arms, you guarded our well-being and honor, and to your devotion to the cause which we had espoused, we are indebted for whatever fame we achieved." The soldiers had watched with pleasure every turn of fortune that has brought you, Hood, success and happiness, they wrote. From Fort Worth, the veterans concluded, "Your marriage to your accomplished wife excited in us hopes that your last years might be freighted with happiness and love, that your children and ours might mingle and recount the deeds of their fathers. But the pall of sadness had fallen on you and yours. Your old comrades share your poignant grief." In a few brief paragraphs, the Texas Brigade survivors captured not only what Hood's wife meant to him, but also what the Hood family meant to the former comrades of war. The bonds of brotherhood forged in that war remained unbroken as the former soldiers stood ready to help out in any means possible, even if many of the men now lived poor, but with knightly honor which belongs to such men. They possessed a sacred trust and promised the trust would be discharged with the fidelity which he, Hood, anticipated, they wrote. Devoted to the commander, the men watched Hood's post-war years with earnest zeal, even if it meant Hood could not join them for every reunion because of his wounds. Yet even as Hood attempted to grieve the loss of his wife, the threat of yellow fever remained within the doors of the Hood home. Hood's eldest daughter contracted the disease the day after the funeral of her mother, and then the general himself started to show signs of yellow fever. Hood and his eldest daughter both died on August the 30th. With the rest of the Hood children, all 10 of them, including the three sets of twins, surviving, they were now orphaned. The glowing tributes to Hood poured forth at memorial services and in newspaper obituaries and completely shifted the tenor of remembering Hood and his military career. One writer recalled, "There died in this city on yesterday a battle-scarred warrior whose name will ever rank among the bravest and most dashing of the leaders on one side of the late lamentable war." The Chicago Tribune wrote, "At dawn this morning, General John B. Hood, the distinguished Confederate chieftain, breathed his last. General Hood's malady was the result of over-anxiety and care, watching at the bedside of his devoted wife. He truly died of a broken heart." Another writer recalled, "That, having in 4 years of constant warfare borne himself with a courage, a devotion, and a heroism that has never been excelled, having sacrificed his body limb by limb to the cause he held dear, having never despaired, but ever stood firm and steadfast, stoutest when most assailed, strongest when maimed, that in these things John B. Hood has earned the name of hero and has endeared himself to his survivors in the affectionate regard and respectful homage which are only felt for the noble and the great." The association of the Army of Tennessee with General Pierre-Gustave Toutant Beauregard as president issued a telling memorial that reflected on Hood's military career as one of the most remarkable known in our day. When Hood arrived with the Army in 1864, this memoir wrote, "His towering form and gallant bearing, no less than the martial appearance of his veteran division, inspired us with fresh courage. As Hood led his corps into battle, he emerged from its smoke and carnage, a maimed trunk, which, inspired by a less lofty son, had then sought the retirement of the rear or of the grave. Hood earned his promotion as corps commander due to his unexampled valor and devotion. Even when Hood received command of the Army of Tennessee, the association recalled, "He delivered staggering blows against the immense army that encircled us at Atlanta, well nigh throwing it back in disastrous fight. Finally, as leader of the forlorn hope of the Confederacy, in his brilliant and rapid movement of 400 miles into the enemy's rear, he achieved the signal victory of Franklin." Of note, the veterans of the Army of Tennessee had now reconfigured Hood's Tennessee campaign from an unparalleled disaster in the memory of the Confederacy to Hood trying to achieve a forlorn hope. At Nashville, they wrote, Hood spent the expiring but unavailing force in an effort that staked out all on a final effort and lost all save honor. To sum up the discussion of their commander, the memorial stated, that having in 4 years of constant warfare borne himself with a courage, a devotion, and a heroism that have never been excelled, having sacrificed his body limb by limb to the cause he held dear, having never despaired, but ever stood firm and steadfast, that in these things John B. Hood has earned the name of hero. Now, granted, obituaries tend to include laudatory remarks to bring out the highest qualities of any individual suffering a tragic death. Yet with Hood, his obituary writers and speakers did not ignore his military failures. Rather, they mentioned them, but then went on to emphasize Hood's other qualities that they felt should dominate his memory, rather than just 6 months of utter military failure. Despite the body of praiseworthy statements offered about John Bell Hood following his death, more pressing matters faced the remaining members of Hood's family, the health and welfare of the remaining children. Organizers worked quickly to start a fund to raise money for the health and future education of Hood's children. Such a fund was necessary because the Hood estate did not furnish enough revenue to support the surviving children. The kids, in essence, emerged as the living monuments of John Bell Hood, and thus benefactors, rather than giving funds to construct some bronze or marble image of the general riding aboard California Chrome, without the nasal strips, of course, they gave money to maintain the health and future education of the orphan children. As Clark Howell, an editor for the Atlanta paper, stated, "Tombstones and statues crumble and decay, and even while they stand, their inscriptions fade from sight. But living monuments are worth more than all." In September, D.M. Hollingsworth, a prominent resident of New Orleans, placed an advertisement in the newspapers. Hollingsworth announced that he would take one of my light spar spring no-top buggies and put it up for a raffle or lottery. For the proposed lottery to take place, Hollingsworth would have the tickets printed, numbered, and stamped, and furnished them to the president, officers, and members of the Associations of Armies of Tennessee and of Northern Virginia. Then Hollingsworth pleaded with the citizenry of the city, as well as the former Confederate soldiers and officers, writing, "I would request them to aid and assist in keeping those little ones from actual want. Soldiers, Christians, friends of the lamented Hood, you know your duty. Do it, and God will bless you." Now, Hollingsworth was not the only individual willing to sacrifice for the benefit of John Bell Hood's legacy. The citizens of Laredo, Texas, and Montgomery, Alabama, each auctioned off a bale of cotton to raise money for Hood's orphans. An unnamed woman in Lowndes County, Alabama, raised money for him and an abundant and beautiful growth of her hair, clipped from her own head. There was a description put forth about this hair sacrifice, and it said, "She is poor in the world's goods, but rich in the finer and gentle impulses, so characteristic of Southern womanhood. She shrinks from notoriety and is only solicitous to her duty in rendering such help as she can to the orphans." Although she couldn't contribute financially, this donor gave away a prized possession, her beautiful hair, to help secure the 10 orphan children that she never personally knew. College Temple from Georgia offered tuition for 1 year for one of the children. W.D. Chipley from Pensacola, Florida offered $5 with a note. "It will be a burning shame upon our people if the little band of babies ever want for a comfort or an advantage that money will procure." Two small children toddled into the offices of the Columbus, Georgia Inquirer and each held out a silver dollar. One of the children said, "We want to give $2 to the Hood children." An Arkansas veteran of the Army of Tennessee who fought under Johnston and who had offered a very small sum but wrote, "Allow me to contribute towards the support and education of the orphans of the noble, true, brave General Hood. A man never recreant to duty, of spotless character, unquestioned integrity, true to himself, his family, his country, his God. His offspring should be cherished and nourished by his fellow countrymen." Support also came in the form of Northern donations. G.F. Moody, who was a Union veteran, offered $5 with a note that said, "All good men must sympathize with the family of a good and brave soldier overtaken by misfortune." Colonel L.P. Bradley, presently serving in the 13th Infantry with the United States Army, offered his regimental band to perform in the aid of a fund for General Hood's children. "I shall be happy," he wrote, "if this small service adds to the success of your noble efforts in behalf of the orphans." One of the most surprising contributors to this fund, I discovered, was former President Ulysses S. Grant when he, in November of 1879, traveled to Portland, Oregon. Grant's presence in the region inspired a reception, which nearly every man, woman, and child in the county attended. Coincidentally, on the same evening of that said reception, the Portland Theater held a charitable performance of Ours, of which half of the proceeds would be donated to a charitable cause. Grant, who was described by a local reporter as an old Roman and hero, deserted his own reception at a very early hour, and the hero of the Union during the Civil War went instead to the theater. The former military commander sat conscientiously through a long and rather dreary performance, according to the editor. Due to a large number of empty seats, the Portland Theater raised only a small sum of money for the charity. However, an observer declared that the funds raised are better than nothing, and shows at least that everybody's heart is in the right place. What charity did these funds go to? You guessed it, the Hood Orphan Fund. Thus, Grant attended the performance not only to probably escape the crowds at the reception, but also in hope of helping dear old Hood's little ones, he said. The most sympathetic notes and donations came from Hood's fellow comrades in arms during the war, who essentially adopted the children of Hood as the children of the Confederate cause. Some offered money, even with their own well-being in question. One soldier gave $1 and offered his regrets, saying, "I have but little to give, but I divide with these poor children." J.S. Todd, who had lost an arm while serving with General Hood, gave $5. The plight of the Hood children garnered notice not only from across the Confederate veteran spectrum, but from overseas as well, from the wealthy to the destitute. An unnamed Englishman offered $5 because he was touched by reading about the pity of the poor children and has an unbounded admiration for the Confederacy, he wrote. Each donation eventually helped secure the Hood children as living monuments that and eventually totaled out at $74,663.20, which was raised by May the 25th of 1895. The most fitting tributes to Hood, besides his children, even came within the Hood family circle. When John Bell Hood died on August the 30th of 1879, Ida Richardson Hood, one of the 10 remaining children, was only 3 years old. On September the 4th, 1904, the 25th anniversary of her father's death, she offered a telling in memoriam. She wrote, "But he has one of the bravest who never spared himself, sharing with his men all the burdens, the joys, and sorrows. He was more than merely their general officer commanding. He was their friend, doubly so as they reciprocated his feelings. Concerning the mistakes that Hood had made in battle, he would not have hesitated, like Cotton Mather, to unbare his head at the corners of the street and ask forgiveness of everybody," his daughter recalled. To conclude, she elevated his character to a higher plane by writing, "Refined by sorrow, purified by aspirations, strengthened through self-reliance, and made gentle by an earnest faith, he was genial, generous, and indulgent towards others, and severe with himself. His aims were promoted by the noble desires, and in politics his desires for democratic action were high. He knew his powers and also his limitations, and he had his limits as the sun has its spots. Above all, the strong force of his character yielded an influence no oratory can command, and that influence is not ended. Nay, it is only beginning to sprout in our hearts." Instrumental in securing the welfare of the Hood children, Hood's Texas Brigade Association remained active well after the passing of John Bell Hood. In 1907, they named J.B. Polly to serve as the historian who would collect data from every available source and give to the world a fair and impartial history of Hood's Texas Brigade. In 1911, the association adopted a resolution to ask the state of Texas to set aside June 27th, the anniversary of the Battle of Gaines Mill, as a legal holiday to be called Hood's Texas Brigade Day. Unfortunately for the society, the Texas legislature never adopted the resolution. In 1924, John Bell Hood II, now 52 years old, his wife, and three-year-old son, John Bell Hood III, attended the dwindling Texas Brigade's annual reunion. Hood addressed the reunion, calling it the proudest moment of his life to stand with his father's old comrades. At the end of the address, John Bell Hood III, holding a small Confederate flag, appeared seated on the table in front of the small of the crowd. The association was moved by this moment of Confederate patriotism and adopted that day John Bell Hood II and his wife as honorary members, and John Bell Hood III as the official mascot. The Hood family, cherished by the aging veterans, returned to the command out of love and remembrance time and time again, serving as proud staples of the Texas Brigade's reunions in 1925, 1926, and 1928. While the image of this late Confederate officer does not appear as statues in town squares, his likeness has been remembered in the faces of both his children and by his veterans, the subsequent generations of family members connected to both entities. However, the maintenance of these living monuments coincided with efforts of the writers who sought to discover why the Confederacy failed in the Civil War. Granted, the heated post-war debates over the status of John Bell Hood in Confederate history paused in order to pay respect to the death of the general. Death came as a time for reassessment, and in many cases, of how an individual had conducted themselves both on and off the field of battle. Without a doubt, the obituaries had conveyed a laudatory aura, filled with praise and sorrow for the passing of the individual. Yet with Hood leaving behind orphan children, both North and South gathered together to go beyond obituaries by raising funds and making sure the health and welfare of the children were secure. By utilizing the name of John Bell Hood, the Confederate veterans in Texas constructed another monument to the general through the maintenance of a home that could care for the remaining members of the Brotherhood of the Texas Brigade. At the same time, defenders and detractors of Hood's leadership capabilities during the war joined forces to secure his memory. While the Southern Historical Society had gained momentum in pitting the Medal of Military Failure in the fall of 1864 squarely on the chest of John Bell Hood, the trickling of memories after his death demonstrates a change in both tone and frequency. In some instances, however, the defenders gained ground with glowing tributes, the publication of the memoirs, and leaving behind the surviving Hood children. Many of these stories and examples have been absent from historical analysis that has judged Hood far too harshly for his military failures at the command helm. Hood, like all his Confederate contemporaries, including Robert E. Lee, and this may be shocking news for some individuals, failed eventually in battle. In the end, we as a historical community are left with a swirling tide of positive and negative memories to sort through in order to understand the complexity of our Civil War personalities far beyond the battlefields where they experienced the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. Thank you very much for your time and attention this afternoon. I'd be happy to take any questions that you may have.
Is the change of opinion of Hood during the war merely a result of the level at which he commands? He seems to do well as a brigade and division commander. That's when the Texas Brigade serves under him. And he's not criticized for that.
Right.
Whereas the criticism of him comes as a corps and an army commander. And one other thing is that he seems to come back from these injuries very quickly,
right,
especially the amputation, and could that have affected his performance?
I think I'll address the second part first and then go back to the first part. Can I walk here? Can you hear me okay? And could everyone hear the question all right? In terms of
Hood's amputation is 4 inches from the hip, so measure that much down. That amputation usually resulted in about an 80% mortality rate. 4 out of every 5 soldiers who underwent that operation died during the course of the war. So it was pretty extreme, and the fact that he recovered from that and was back on his horse by January of 1864, so we're talking about from September, middle of September through December, recovering mostly in bed, moving around from time to time on crutches. But that has become the source of speculation for many historians who have wondered, well, because Hood had that severe of an injury, he must have been on something, right? He must have been drinking all the time because he had to be strapped into the saddle for 12, 13, 14 hours a day, particularly when this army is moving great distances on the Atlanta campaign through Georgia and back all the way up towards Nashville, Tennessee. Maybe he was drinking, maybe he was taking laudanum, a derivative of opium that was from time to time included when you bought a prosthetic leg. One of Hood's legs that he wore that dangled over the side of his saddle came from France. And a lot of those legs usually had a bottle of laudanum included. I guess it's like when you buy steak knives on TV and they give you the free one to cut your tomatoes and then your rusty pipes and then the tomato again, that one that you can keep. The laudanum apparently was one of these gifts that you got. And so historians have assumed that Hood must have been on this drug the entire time and affected his ability. We don't know, because for the longest period of time, that Hood's medical diary that was kept by his personal surgeon had disappeared. It was in existence probably in someone's attic, but we don't know where it is. It's actually about to be published by Stephen Hood's collection of lost papers on General John Bell Hood. And Mr. Hood has told me that that diary does not reveal any details of the doctor prescribing laudanum. So clearly, we have to excise this comment about drugs or alcohol related to Hood's injuries and affecting his command ability. As for his tenure with the Army of Tennessee, I would largely say that we don't see a lot of soldiers coming forward initially as the memory wars are heating up in the 1870s. Particularly a lot of the folks getting involved in that battle are officers. And the soldiers seem to be siding with Joseph Johnston until Hood's death. And there we start to see a recalculation of some of the men who probably complained quite a bit under Hood's tenure, now saying, well, he wasn't so much of a bad guy. He was really brave and gallant. He sacrificed his body. He made decisions. That seems to coincide with the same moment, if you will, where the lost cause starts to pivot a little bit about how they are personally reinterpreting Franklin and Nashville and Atlanta, from going from this unmitigated disaster, it's Hood's fault, to, well, he probably didn't stand a chance anyways. Johnson had given up too much ground. What else are you going to do at that late stage of the war? But it does seem to me, particularly by reading the correspondence of the soldiers, that their memory really starts to change, particularly once Hood passes away. And that shuts up a lot of the critics. A lot of those generals and officers who have been writing to the Southern Historical Society are no longer writing those papers. There's sort of a silence. And then the Southern Historical Society moves on to other matters. So thank you very much for your question. Anybody else?
Much like Winnie Davis, the daughter of Jefferson Davis, became a symbol of the lost cause during the years of Reconstruction in the 1880s and 1890s. Do we see any of the orphans of John Bell Hood's family becoming an iconic figure or an important figure for Confederate lost cause mythology and storytelling?
Oh, I think absolutely. There, and I wasn't able to bring it with me today. There's this photograph that they actually took of Hood's 10 orphan children, and then they had photos inserted within the picture of Hood, his wife, and eldest daughter to create the whole family portrait. And this was sent out, and they used this to raise money. And it was helpful when it was published to garner a lot of attention, because that's, I mean, you read any newspapers, and for those of you out there in the audience or out on the web who are interested in becoming historians professionally or personally in your own life, I would encourage you to read newspapers. A lot of the work that I did for Hood's post-war life was just done reading the New Orleans newspapers every single day. Now a lot of them are searchable, but what I was able to find is, particularly after Hood's death, you see constant stories on the front page about the orphans. And what is the status of the orphans? And you start to see a little, some of these little tidbit stories being published of, oh yes, someone came in our newspaper editorial offices and offered a dollar to the cause. A lot of the times they're actually bringing up that lost cause rhetoric in their contributions of the donation. We feel so sorry for General Hood and what he had sacrificed, what these children had sacrificed. That seems, though, to be a brief window in the overarching spectrum of the lost cause from about 1879 through about 1885. Then things start to fade off in terms of donations, and the Hood children start to grow up and move on, and you start to see other endeavors. But it does seem to be, particularly in the reading of the national newspapers all across the North and South, that Hood's children are really the focus of lost cause memories, and how if you have any devotion to the cause, if you remember fondly the Confederacy, if you knew someone who fought with General Hood, if you believe that children shouldn't be orphaned, then you should give a little bit of money to this cause, which I think pulled at a lot of heartstrings and brought in a lot of cash. Thank you. Anybody else? Al Mackey doesn't have a question. Brooke Simpson, if you're watching, this is a rarity moment, right? I was ready, Al. I was ready for your question. Stumped you today. Yes, sir.
I'm just curious where the Texas Brigade Memorial is in Austin. I know Albert Sidney Johnson has an elaborate tomb there in the old state cemetery, but I have no idea where that monument is.
It's on the Capitol grounds of the Texas State House there. It was actually rededicated 4 years, 3 years ago, 2012, the monument was rededicated. Within the last few years. I'm sorry, I don't have the exact date here. Well, thank you all so much for attending today. I greatly appreciate your attention and the great questions. Enjoy the rest of your time here at Gettysburg.